ancient archaeological objects in our possession today provide a glimpse into a past that is hundreds, sometimes thousands of years old. Think of the Chabot Cave in southeastern France, which contains 30,000-year-old cave drawings of a pack of woolly rhinos, a species now long extinct. These ancient artworks were created by our human ancestors at a time when there was more than one species of sapiens existing on Earth simultaneously. Then there are archaeological artifacts that are associated with what you can call legendary history. For example, there are multiple chalices or grails throughout the world whose owners allege that are the authentic cup that Jesus Christ used at the Last Supper. There is the grail kept at the Cathedral of Valencia in Spain. Then there is the Nantillos cup, a wooden mazer bowl kept at the Nantillos mansion in Aberystwyth in the country of Wales. I know, I probably butchered that pronunciation. And then there is a silver gilt object stored oddly at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. The origin of this object has been traced back to the ancient city of Antioch during the early 6th century, and is again touted as the cup that Christ used in his last meal with his disciples. For reasons that I will leave to a future episode of the podcast, I believe the authentic Holy Grail is the one kept in Valencia, in Spain. And ancient artifacts associated with religious movements are not only given further veneration by followers, but also those movements themselves grow to an extent where they now give these objects such as the tunic of the Blessed Virgin Mary or the footprint of the Prophet Muhammad, a sense of sacredness and hallowedness. These types of objects could be labeled as religious relics, a term used to describe either the actual physical remains or personal items associated with the person of saintly nature for purposes of veneration. The most famous religious relic associated with any faith or religious denomination is the object whose mysterious origins and even more mysterious nature will be the discussion of today's episode of the Paranormal Nothing podcast. The object is none other than the Shroud of Turin, a roughly 14 by 3.5 foot woven cloth kept in the Cathedral of San Giovanni Battista or St. John the Baptist in Turin, Italy, whose believers state covered the body of Jesus Christ as he laid in the tomb after his crucifixion. As a preface to the episode, I'd like to state that I am a practicing Roman Catholic, as I've mentioned earlier in episodes of the podcast, but I will approach the analysis on the authenticity of the Shroud in today's episode from an entirely scientific perspective. Only empirical, non-equivocal evidence will be considered, and only from an objective point of view. With that said, before we get into the Shroud history, let's first start by providing a description of what the Shroud looks like, as well as some facts about its makeup. As mentioned earlier, the Shroud is a woven cloth composed of flax fibers. It measures roughly 14 feet in length and then 3.5 feet in width. The color of the Shroud is a distinct straw yellowish hue. If you stretched out and laid out the Shroud end to end on a flat surface, the first thing you notice is that it would show some noticeable dark blemishes lengthwise along the crease lines that were formed when it was folded, most probably for storage. In between these dark blemishes would be the noticeable image of a person whose hands are folded across the groin area. But this image would not look like a Renaissance painting or even a medieval relief. Instead, the image would look like a stain, brownish in color, but in the shape of a person. Halfways, lengthwise, when looking at the Shroud, you would then notice that a distinct dark blemish would appear widthwise, indicating that this cloth had been folded at that crease line under and over the figure that the Shroud represented. This technique of wrapping the body in a linen cloth could be equated to wrapping a Christmas gift. In other words, you would cover the top and bottom of the gift with the same piece of wrapping paper. This technique of wrapping the body that the Shroud exhibited had therefore created both a front view and a back view to the person whose body was portrayed on the Shroud. The person that the Shroud depicts measured roughly 6 feet in height, and based on the location and sharpness of the brownish color used to create the image of the person on the Shroud, it can be deduced that this person had a beard, a mustache, and also shoulder-length hair. Also, based on the anatomical structure and musculature that the image of the Shroud shows, even though it was created using a brownish, not very clear medium, it could also be concluded that the image of the Shroud was a male. Then, when looking at the Shroud, if it was to be laid out lengthwise, the next noticeable item you would see would be a series of red, blotchy stains throughout the front and back of the Shroud. These stains would look noticeably different from the dark blemishes that ran lengthwise on the Shroud, where it presumably was folded and creased for storage. and these red stains would also look different from the pigmentation of the actual image of the man on the shroud. These red blotchy stains would be very noticeable on the forehead, on the wrists, on the forearms, and on the side of the image. What we've just described was the Shroud of Turin from an entirely objective perspective, almost like a bird's eye view. If you were to see the Shroud, for example, on a random visit to Turin, without any knowledge of what believers of the Shroud indicate that it could really be. Let's now take a journey through history to see where we first see the Shroud mentioned, as well as how it reached its current residence in the Cathedral of San Giovanni Battista in Turin, Italy. We'll start with the presumption that since the Shroud has been venerated throughout history, it is because the image on the Shroud is purported to be that of Jesus Christ. With that said, we do encounter an account of a cloth covering the body of Jesus after he is brought down from the tomb. This is found in all of the Gospels. In the Gospel of Luke, we read the following. And he took it down, and wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb cut into the rock, where no one had lain. In the Gospel of John, the following longer account appears.
And Nicodemus came also, who had first come to him by night, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds weight. And so they took the body of Jesus, and bound it in linen wrappings with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet laid. Therefore, on account of the Jewish day of preparation, because the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
Finally, in a more interesting twist of the story, also from the Gospel of John, we see mention of two distinct pieces of cloth, one for Jesus' body and one for his head. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. This is an interesting detail, and we will discuss this more in depth later on in today's episode. Most biblical scholars believe that the Gospels were written between 60 and 110 years after the death of Jesus. If we can assume that the Gospels contain a factual account of the events surrounding Jesus' death, then the Gospel accounts of a linen cloth wrapping the body of Jesus after he is brought down from the cross would in theory be the first times in recorded history where we see mention of the Shroud. After the Gospels, we will have to wait over 1,000 years to hear about the Shroud once again in recorded history. That comes in the year 1349, where a French knight named Geoffrey de Charny makes a request to Pope Clement VI, asking for permission to build a church in Liray, France. Charny's intention in building the church is for honoring the Holy Trinity, since he believed that his prayers were answered and life was saved multiple times while he was previously a prisoner in England. Pope Clement grants this permission to Charny, who has a church built. The inauguration for this church took place on June 20, 1353. And part of this inauguration included the exposition of what was called the Holy Winding Sheet, a name given at the time to what we know now as the Shroud of Turin. How did Geoffrey de Charny come into possession of the Shroud? There are no undisputed historical records for this, but it is presumed that he obtained it during the Smyrna Crusade, which he campaigned in starting in 1345. The ancient city of Smyrna was located in what is today modern Turkey. Presuming Charny obtained the Shroud in Smyrna, how did the Shroud end up there, since Smyrna, or as the region is known today, Izmir, is roughly 2,000 kilometers from Jerusalem? We'd have to look at Constantinople as a possible answer to that question. Constantinople would have been located in what is today the Turkish capital of Istanbul. In the year 330, the Roman Emperor Constantine gave the name Constantinople for the obvious reasons, to the city which was previously known as Byzantium, as it served as a capital of the Byzantine Empire. Constantine, however, went as far as transferring the capital of the Roman Empire from Rome to this new city of Constantinople. During the initial years of Constantine's reign over Constantinople, he had empowered his mother, named Helena, with monies and resources in order to embark on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem in order to locate and retrieve relics associated with the Christian faith. Helena went on this pilgrimage, and tradition holds that she not only had churches built on where were the purported sites of the Nativity and the Ascension of Jesus in the Mount of Olives, but that she also returned to Constantinople with pieces of the true cross on which Jesus was crucified on, in addition to the actual nails that were used to nail Jesus on the cross. If Helena did actually return to Constantinople with these religious relics associated with the crucifixion of Jesus, it's not a far-reaching guess that she might have also returned with the Shroud of Turin as well. Constantinople was located 500 kilometers from what would have been the city of Smyrna, both Turkish cities. Again, it's not a far reach to conjecture that Geoffrey de Charny had obtained the shroud in Smyrna, but that it originally had been brought from Jerusalem by way of Constantinople. The shroud would remain in the Charny family at the Lyrae Church until 1418. During the time from 1349 until 1418, it was exhibited often at the Charny Church in Lyrae, even though some church officials, such as Bishop Pierre d'Arcis of the nearby city of Troyes, proclaimed that the shroud was a forgery. However, this does not stop an influx of visitors to the Lyrae Church in hopes of seeing the man on the shroud for themselves. As mentioned, in 1418, the shroud is then finally moved in what is planned as a temporary move to a new location at a castle in Montfort in the French commune of Montbard. The castle belongs to Humbert of Irsexel, who has married into the Charny family. The purpose for the planned temporary move of the shroud is for safekeeping, since Lyrae was being attacked often by marauding groups of criminals that would ransack and attack cities that they passed through in their treks. What occurs next is a lengthy legal battle in the French courts, since after Humbert of Irsexel dies in 1438, his widow, Margaret, of the Charny bloodline, refuses to return the shroud to Lyrae. Margaret, while these battles in court take place, exhibits the shroud often at the Montfort Castle for both private and public audiences. The court battles would never be fully resolved in favor of returning the shroud to Lyrae, and so in 1453, Margaret decides to sell the shroud to Duke Louis I of Savoy, a region located near the French-Swiss border. In return for the shroud, Margaret receives a castle as well as some monies generated by the selling of a separate Savoy property. History shows that the shroud would remain in the Savoy Chapel of Sainte-Chapelle at Chambéry until 1471. It is of note also that from 1453, when the Duke of Savoy acquired the shroud, until his death in 1465, the Savoy family had agreed to pay the original Lyrae caretakers of the shroud an annual renter's fee as restitution for Margaret selling the Savoy family the shroud and refusing to return it to Lyrae. These rental payments would stop once the Duke of Savoy's son, named Amadeus, would take over his father's position as Duke. It is in 1471 when we see the shroud transferred from Chambéry in the Savoy Swiss-French region to the Italian city of Vercelli, located in the northwest part of Italy known as the Piedmont region. The shroud is then actually moved to Turin, Italy, 2 years later in 1473. But between 1473 and 1502, the shroud is moved and exhibited throughout Italy and France, including in the cities such as Ivrea, Moncalieri, Susa Avigliano Rivoli, Pinerolo, and multiple times as Chambéry as well. Then in 1502, the shroud gained some stability after moving to a renovated Sainte-Chapelle. When the shroud is moved to the new Sainte-Chapelle, silversmiths of the time have created for it a silver gilt reliquary in order to safely store it, and it is then placed in a special hollowed-out cavity dug out secretly behind the main altar wall. Then, iron grill bars are placed on the cavity opening, together with four locks that used four different keys. This created the perfect long-term storage location for the shroud. This secure compartment for the shroud would come in handy since in 1532, a fire breaks out at Sainte-Chapelle. Due to the tight entrance to the reliquary cavity, blacksmiths are not able to retrieve the silver-lit case where the shroud is kept until the fire is extinguished completely. By then, the silver box has completely melted. Miraculously, the shroud inside the melted box remains mostly intact, with the exception of some minor scorch marks and a hole that formed in the corner of the folded shroud due to a drop of molten silver having fallen directly on it. An order of local nuns, the Chambéry Port Claire nuns, repair the shroud and then return it to the Savoy Castle in Chambéry. This fire would, however, leave the burn and scorch marks on the shroud that we see in the shroud today. After the fire, the shroud would be moved and exhibited in different churches and chapels within Italy and France, including the cities of Milan, Nice, Vercelli, arriving ultimately in Turin on September 14, 1578. Since then, it has remained in Turin and, as mentioned, is currently safeguarded at the Cathedral of San Giovanni Battista. Once it arrived permanently in Turin, exhibits of the Shroud have not been free of drama. A May 9, 1606 public viewing of the Shroud drew over 40,000 foreigners that had traveled to Turin to see it. Then a May 4, 1647 public viewing, held this time inside the cathedral, drew so many people that many present in the cathedral were trampled on and died of injuries and suffocation. But the Shroud would remain in Turin through present times, and only left Turin for Naples during a brief period from 1939 to 1946 to secure its safekeeping as a result of the onset of World War II. This brings us to contemporary times for the Shroud. It was publicly exposed recently in 2020 in what was termed as an extraordinary public display as a result of petitions to expose the Shroud for viewing due to the COVID-19 pandemic that was ravaging Italy. The 2020 exposure of the Shroud was done virtually via livestream. Prior to the 2020 public viewing, the Shroud had been exposed to the public in 2015, and it was scheduled to be exposed again in 2025 for the usual public exhibit schedule for the Shroud. Why has this ancient linen, having survived being literally set on fire, having been sold, purchased, and traded within Europe's royal circles over the centuries, having been venerated by hundreds of thousands of people looking to see a glimpse of the man on the cloth, why has it continued to elude both debunkers and believers in its claim of having been the actual burial cloth of Jesus of Nazareth? Let's take a look now at the evidence in favor and against the authenticity of the Shroud of Turin as a burial garment of Jesus Christ. There is an enormous amount of data available arguing that the Shroud was the actual burial cloth of Jesus. Equally, there is a lot of data arguing that the Shroud was a more recent relic and that it was created as a hoax or for other purposes. Regardless, rather than look at all of the volumes of data on these claims, we will instead focus on two key arguments from both sides of the spectrum, arguments that have been discussed widely throughout the years and that remain open-ended. To start, as of the writing of this podcast, the Shroud continues to be one of the most studied objects, if not the most studied object, in human history. There is even a term now given to the professional study of the Shroud. That term is Signology. Given this fact, and with the advances of modern science, it's interesting to note that no definitive conclusion on its authenticity has to this day been agreed upon by scientists of all branches. Let's start with the arguments against the Shroud's authenticity. The most notable of these arguments is in relation to radiocarbon testing done on the Shroud in order to determine its age. Radiocarbon dating is a technique by which a plant or animal or other organic material, such as a Shroud, which was made of flax fibers, stops producing radioactive carbon dioxide upon its death. So after death, the amount of radiocarbon, short for radioactive carbon dioxide, left over begins to decay. Scientists can measure the leftover amount of the radiocarbon in order to determine when the plant, animal, or organic material ultimately died. The radiocarbon testing that was done on the Shroud was initially proposed by the STURP group, short for Shroud of Turin Research Project. This group, composed of scientists from various religious faiths, was created by the Catholic Church in 1978 in order to lead the scientific study of trying to determine the Shroud's authenticity. Although there were some disagreements regarding the samples taken from the Shroud, as well as in regarding the standard operating procedures that would be followed in conducting the testing, the radiocarbon dating on the Shroud would ultimately take place in 1988. Three distinct controlled tests were performed by three different laboratories, one in Tucson, Arizona, one in Oxford, England, and one in Zurich, Switzerland. The tests were done on a sample of cloth that had been cut from near the edge of the Shroud and then divided into three for the three labs. On October 13th of the same year, the results of the radiocarbon testing were released via press conference, and later in the science journal Nature. The conclusion was that all three labs coincided in dating the creation of the Shroud to roughly the year 1325. This matched closely with the first historical record of the Shroud in 1349, via the person of Geoffrey de Charny. If the Shroud was created sometime around the year 1325, then it could not have possibly covered the body of Jesus of Nazareth more than 1,000 years earlier, and thus, the Shroud should be considered a medieval hoax. That was the first argument against the authenticity of the Shroud. The second argument has to do with another legendary historical religious image known as the Image of Edessa, referred to sometimes as the Holy Mandylion of Edessa as well. As mentioned earlier, the Gospel of John indicates that the body of Jesus, after being taken down from the cross, was wrapped in two pieces of linen cloth, one for his body and one for his head. Enter the figure of Apgar V, who was the king of Osroni, whose capital was Edessa. Osroni was located in modern-day Turkey. Apgar came to power sometime around the year 4 BC and died in the year 50 BC. He is known in history as being one of the first members of royalty in ancient times to convert to Christianity, and how that happened has a connection to the story of the Shroud of Turin. The story goes that King Apgar wrote a letter to Jesus, asking Jesus to cure him of an illness he had come down with. This is what the letter states.
Apgar, ruler of Edessa, to Jesus the good physician who has appeared in the country of Jerusalem, greeting. I have heard the reports of you and of your cures as performed by you without medicines or herbs. For it is said that you make the blind to see and the lame to walk, that you cleanse lepers and cast out impure spirits and demons, and that you heal those afflicted with lingering disease, and that you raise the dead. And having heard all of these things concerning you, I have concluded that one of the two things must be true. Either you are God, and having come down from heaven you do these things, or else you, who does these things, are the Son of God. I have therefore written to you to ask you if you would take the trouble to come to me and heal all the ill which I suffer. For I have heard that the Jews are murmuring against you and are plotting to injure you, but I have a very small yet noble city which is great enough for both of us.
The story gets even more interesting since apparently Jesus wrote a reply to Apgar.
Blessed are you who has believed in me without having seen me, for it is written concerning me that they who have seen me will not believe in me, and that they who have not seen me will believe and be saved. But in regard to what you have written me, that I should come to you, it is necessary for me to fulfill all things here for which I have been sent, and after I have fulfilled them thus, to be taken up again to him that sent me. But after I have been taken up, I will send to you one of my disciples, that he may heal your disease and give life to you and yours.
We know about this alleged correspondence between Apgar and Jesus based on the writings of a figure named Egeria, a foreigner who visited Edessa sometime during the year 384 AD. The bishop of Edessa would apparently give Egeria transcripts of the correspondence that had occurred between Apgar and Jesus. These transcripts were originally written by Eusebius of Caesarea, a 4th century church scholar who claimed to have transcribed the actual return reply sent from Jesus to Apgar. Although there is no historical evidence for when this disciple of Jesus visited Apgar, Jesus' response in the letter implies that the disciple would visit Apgar after Jesus' death. The legend goes that St. Jude the Apostle later made the visit to Edessa, and upon bringing news of Jesus to Apgar, Apgar was miraculously healed of his illness. However, before St. Jude the Apostle visited, another part of the story says that Apgar had one of his court artists, a painter, visit Jesus and request that Jesus allow the painter to create a portrait of him. According to the 4th century work titled The Doctrine of Adai, when Hanan, the keeper of the archives, saw that Jesus spoke thus to him, by virtue of being the king's painter, he took and painted a likeness of Jesus with choice paints, and brought with him to Apgar the king, his master. And when Apgar the king saw the likeness, he received it with great joy, and placed it with great honor in one of his palatial houses. And that is how the famous image of Edessa, a purported hand-painted image of Jesus, came to being. The image of Edessa is often confused with the image of the face of Jesus, known as the Veil of Veronica, or the Sudarium, another Christian relic thought to be the cloth which Veronica used to wipe the face of Jesus as he carried the cross towards Calvary. There are many images found in churches and museums today that lay claim to being the real image of Edessa, or the real Veil of Veronica. The names of some of these images include the Holy Face of Genoa, the San Silvestro image, the Vatican Veronica, the Holy Face of Vienna, and the Holy Face of Jaén. Many shroud researchers, including famed English shroud researcher Ian Wilson, believe that the image of Edessa and the Shroud of Turin are one and the same. If this is the case and the image of Edessa was known as being a painting of Jesus created by an artist from King Apgar's court, then the Shroud of Turin / image of Edessa could not have been created by the crucified body of Jesus being wrapped in a cloth and laid in a tomb. Let's now switch gears and take a look at the two strongest arguments in favor of the authenticity of the Shroud of Turin. The first argument is related to the makeup of the actual image of the man on the shroud. During a public exhibition of the shroud in Turin in 1898, an Italian lawyer slash amateur photographer named Secondo Pia took what would become the first ever photographs of the shroud. As he was developing the photographs, he noticed that the negatives that he was working off of showed a very peculiar image. The negatives actually showed a much clearer image of the man on the shroud, as opposed to viewing the shroud with the naked eye. For the face, the negative image that Secondo Pia saw showed clear cheekbones, a mustache, a beard, long hair, and closed eyes. For areas around the forehead, there were white streaks. As Secondo looked on at the rest of the shroud in the negative, a great many white streaks throughout the rest of the surface of the man on the shroud can now be clearly seen. The white streaks were more noticeable near the wrist and pelvic areas, as well as near the ankles. Both the front and back negative images of the man on the shroud showed a tremendous amount of these white streaks. Of note is that most depictions of Jesus created over the centuries showed the wounds on the palms of his hands as a result of the nails driven through these for purposes of nailing him to the cross. This negative image coming from the shroud now showed these wounds on the wrists. Investigative scientists would many years later state that in order for a person to have withstood the weight and pushing down of the body when hanging from the cross, the nails would have had to been driven through the wrists of the crucified person, since the ligaments around the wrists were much stronger than the palms. But this also would have been much more painful, due to the additional nerve endings in the wrists as opposed to the palms. The other noticeable white areas, as opposed to the negative black areas, were the known burn marks on its fold lines caused by the fire of 1532. The negative black area showed the clear musculature of a thin, tall man who appeared to have gone through a tremendous amount of suffering. This is because the white streaks throughout the body represented areas where the naked eye shroud showed signs of bloodstains. Secondo Pia, the amateur photographer who had stumbled on this discovery, could not believe what he was seeing. The church and the media would quickly find out about this development, and so the news would spread about this negative image supposedly created during the 1300s. The combination of these facts did not make sense. Because Secondo Pia was an amateur photographer, his techniques and methods were drawn into question. Pia would have to wait 33 more years for professional photographer Giuseppe Endri to also photograph the shroud, and he too arrived at the same results. The negative image showed a much clearer picture of a man that had undergone some painful suffering, possibly due to torture, and had then succumbed to his injuries. But here is a mystery. If the shroud really was a medieval forgery, created by a 14th century artist of some sort, how could it be possible for this mystery artist to have drawn a hidden negative image underneath a superficial image, all while using only the tools and technology available in 1300s Europe or Asia? This is even more far-fetched if you consider the shroud to actually be the image of Edessa, since the story of the Edessa image is even older than the medieval accounts of the shroud. Scientific analyses done over the years have resulted in many theories for the composition of the image of the man on the shroud, including paint pigmentation, acid pigmentation, and theories about it being a relief due to its three-dimensional properties. However, none of these theories fully explain all of the anomalies that are present on the image of the shroud, especially the fact that there was a hidden negative image. There is one explanation that would appear to explain specifically the creation of the negative image. The following is the abstract from a study published in the Journal of Imaging Science and Technology in the March 2010 issue. The author is shroud researcher Giulio Fanti of the University of Padua in Italy.
The body image visible on the Turin shroud has not yet been explained by science. This article proposes a hypothesis of image formation based on a corona discharge. Even if the environmental hypothesis relative to a corona discharge can be refined, many facts detected on the shroud body image seem in agreement with the characteristics of an energy connected to a corona discharge and related to the human body enveloped in it. After a synthesis of the proposed imaging mechanisms and a presentation of the main characteristics of a corona discharge, the results, both at macroscopic and microscopic levels, of some experiments are presented and discussed also in light of some comments coming from the scholars of Shroud Science Group. The results support the hypothesized mechanism of image formation, and they show no appreciable chemical-physical differences from the image features of the shroud. Therefore, they confirm that the proposed corona discharge mechanism could have been involved in the shroud body image formation.
A corona discharge is an electrical discharge caused by the ionization of fluid such as air surrounding a conductor that is electrically charged. The corona discharge will occur in high voltage systems unless sufficient care is taken to limit the strength of the surrounding electrical fields. If a corona discharge was to be proposed as the cause of the creation of the image on the shroud, what could have possibly caused the corona discharge in the first place? For believers in the story of Jesus, this could be explained by his resurrection. An internal discharge, a corona discharge, in theory, could have been the source energy involved in the act of the resurrection, and would therefore have been the culprit in creating the image of the man on the shroud. But there is no scientific explanation for how such an internal, bodily, corona discharge might have been generated from a dead body. The rest of this explanation is left for you, the listener, to fill in the gaps. Let's now discuss the second and final argument in favor of the authenticity of the shroud. It is directly connected to the 1988 radiocarbon dating that the STRP team led with the assistance of three independent labs in Arizona, Oxford, and Zurich. When those results were released to the scientific community and subsequently the media, not all members of those groups agreed with the methodologies involved in collecting the samples that were taken from the shroud for radiocarbon dating, and so they also did not agree on the results that were obtained. The first disagreement was about the area of the shroud that the 1988 samples were taken from. According to STRP team member Raymond Rogers, samples taken for the radiocarbon test were taken from an area of the shroud that had gone through medieval repair work. This was determined since the fibers analyzed for the test itself contained elements such as gum, dye, and cotton residues. These elements were not present in the main part of the shroud. Rogers believed that these ghost elements in the sample taken were typical elements you expected to find if a medieval shroud repair team was trying to match the color and the weave pattern of the original shroud. So if the radiocarbon test was done on a younger patch of weave work from the shroud, then the 1325 rough date for the creation of the shroud would be expected, even though it did not represent the main and majority of the shroud itself. In relation to this disagreement on the sample of shroud taken, Raymond Rogers published a paper asserting this finding. The paper was published in the chemistry journal Thermochimica Acta, edition dated January 20th, 2005. As unlikely as it seems, the sample used to test the age of the shroud of Turin in 1988 was taken from a rewoven area of the shroud. Pyrolysis mass spectrometry results from the sample area, coupled with microscopic and microchemical observations, prove that the radiocarbon sample was not part of the original cloth of the shroud of Turin. The radiocarbon date was thus not valid for determining the true age of the shroud. Another problem with the 1988 radiocarbon testing was that factors such as weather, conservation methods employed throughout the centuries, as well as the damage to the shroud due to the 1532 fire while housed at Sainte-Chapelle, were not considered when presenting the results of the radiocarbon test. For example, it was a well-known scientific fact that prolonged exposure to smoke and to fire could alter the carbon content of a material due to the molecular structure of carbon being very volatile. And by altering it, this meant reducing the natural carbon content, causing the material being tested to appear younger than it really was. Based on this information, having this much uncertainty with the so-called established results of the 1988 radiocarbon testing of the shroud would make the end results statistically unbelievable. If we take into consideration the additional variables which we've discussed in regard to the testing, then numerically, the shroud could have been dated to the time of Jesus. Unfortunately, no additional radiocarbon testing of the shroud has been done since 1988. This brings us to the conclusion, and unfortunately, as we've seen, the evidence available is very diverse from both sides of the spectrum, from those in favor of the shroud's authenticity and from those proclaiming it to be a medieval forgery. However, in the opinion of your humble narrator, the evidence in favor of its authenticity, in addition to the evidence against purported proofs of forgery, are much stronger and scientifically sound. The arguments against the authenticity of the shroud are definitely possible, but improbable, statistically speaking. But in the end, belief in Jesus Christ, in the man of the shroud, belief in the shroud of Turin itself, will always be a matter of faith. To conclude today's episode of the Paranormal Nothing podcast, I want to leave you with a brief description of the shroud mystery, as written by Barry Schwartz. Schwartz was the chief documenting photographer of the 1978 STIRP team, and to this day, continues to lecture and write about his experience working with the Shroud of Turin.
The Shroud of Turin is a centuries-old linen cloth that bears the image of a crucified man, a man that millions believe to be Jesus of Nazareth. Is it really the cloth that wrapped his crucified body? Or is it simply a medieval forgery, a hoax perpetrated by some clever artist? Modern science has completed hundreds of thousands of hours of detailed study and intense research on the Shroud. It is, in fact, the single most studied artifact in human history, and we know more about it today than we ever have before. And yet, the controversy still rages.
Thank you for listening, and as always, question everything.